have to keep perspective here. I hope with all my heart that the Twins win the division going away and that they go deep into the postseason. I really do. But from where they were a year ago to where they are now, and the prospects they have in the minor leagues, and the prospect of being like this, like the season they're having now, for the next, you know, 10 years, you can't mortgage those 10 years on trying to win this year. I'm not sure they have enough to get all the way to the World Series, yet to be seen. I'm not sure that if they made a blockbuster, you know, if they traded for a really big name person and gave up a couple of guys that were going to be everyday players on, you know, on the mound and at shortstop or third or second, it's just, to me, it's not worth it. That's not worth it. It's not worth going all in on this year when we could be having this kind of fun every year for a long period of time. And the teams that don't, that have, you know, one and dones, or they're good for 2 or 3 years and then not for a long time. It takes a long time to build back when you've decimated your farm system. You can't recover quickly enough, and then you go through lulls like we've been through here in the early part of this decade. So I desperately want them to win. I really want them to get some pitching help if it's reasonable. But I do not want them to. I do not want to be looking back and say, "We almost won in 2019. It was really fun because we got this pitcher." We're in 2022, and we're starting all over again. I mean, that just doesn't make any sense to me.
Right, and Kirilov's hitting 30 homers a year for somebody else, and it reminds me, right, Roy, of a, you know, I don't know, maybe around 2006. I was talking to Morneau before the trading deadline, and on the record, he said, you know, we got to go out and we got to get somebody. We got to add. We got to try to win this year. And he was just adamant, you know, about, and I heard this, often heard the same things from Torrey Hunter and Doug Minkiewicz, people like that, and Eddie Guardado. And it wasn't that they were wrong. It's that they were consumed by the season in which they were playing. And then I went back to Morneau, I don't know, a year or two later, and I said, you know, so do you think this team needs to add at the trading deadline this year? And he said, you know, I saw when you quoted me that one time saying that we needed a trade for people. He said, and I realized what it looked like. It looked like I was saying that my current team isn't good enough, that my current teammates aren't good enough, that I want to get rid of a couple of my current teammates to bring in somebody who's going to play for us for a couple of months. He said, I hated the way that looked. And it looked like, you know, it looked like it looked desperate, you know, and it reminded me that for a trade to really work out, this kind of a trade to really work out, here are the things that have to work. That player has to come in and fit in. You can't bring somebody who's just going to blow up a great clubhouse. That person has to perform well in a very limited window. Because if somebody comes in for 2 months or 2.5 months or whatever it is and doesn't perform right away, it's not a good trade. They have to be on immediately, and they have to be on the entire time they're here. That person has to help you win. Because if that person performs and your team doesn't win, then the trade didn't achieve the desired result. And the people you trade away can't go on to embarrass you by being great someplace else. It's a narrow window that you have to get through to make a successful deal at the trading deadline.
Yeah, great point. And I would just add to that what the Twins, you know, players have a different job to do than the head of baseball operations and the general manager has to do, right? The players' jobs to go out and win the division, win the World Series. I mean, that's what they want to do. That's what they live for. So it's easy to see why, you know, Justin or anybody else would say, you know, we need some help here and there. It's the front office job to recognize and make decisions about where they need help. And then within the context of trying to win this year and trying to be competitive for the next 10, make a deal that fits that. It fits that objective, and not one that fits only one of the objectives. You know, the objective, I really believe, as I said before, the objective should be to win today and have an organization that has a chance to win every year for an extended period of time. And to the degree that a deal is made that that prevents the second thing, is the long-term health of the organization, then I'm not for that. But I'm also not nearly as much for getting a 2-month player as I am a guy that you want to be good for 2 months, but you also want to have him for 3 or 4 or 5 years. I mean,
right. That'd be a different kind of deal. If you can trade for somebody who's going to be part of things for an extended period of time, then you're more willing to give things up.
Right. Right. Exactly. Right.
It also reminds me when Terry Ryan was at his best, he traded people that the market liked, that internally the Twins were not as high on as people thought they were. Think about the best trade deadline deal the Twins have done in a long time, and that was Bobby Kelty for Shannon Stewart. The analytics community thought the Twins were fools because Kelty was a classic power and walks guy, right? And he was still fairly young. Internally, the Twins looked at Kelty and said, man, he looks sluggish. He is not getting the bat head through the zone. He's not producing right now. We think he's going down. And Shannon Stewart, you know exactly what you're getting. And, you know, he's a professional. He doesn't hit. He's not a classic power and walks guy, but you know he can be your leadoff hitter. So the Twins made a deal that was just mocked by the analytics community. And guess what? They nailed it because they knew who they were trading and they knew who they were trading for.
That's right. And the other thing about that, about making trades or free agents or anything else, the most important thing for clubs to do is, in my business, you want to buy when everybody else is afraid to buy, when people are wringing their hands and gnashing their teeth. That's when you buy. And, you know, when you sell, you have to sell when it really feels bad to sell. It's like, well, gosh, everything's been so good. Why would I sell? And you have to make some nibbling purchases at when it doesn't feel good, and you have to nibble out some profits, not sell everything, but you know, nibble out some profits when things are when there is euphoria. In like manner, if you're really going to do this job well, you have to conjecture, or you have to make a decision about when a guy's got, you know, is about done, when his market value is really high and he's got maybe 2 more years or 1 more year or some such, and then trade for guys that have a chance at some point in time in the near future to be good for those 6 or 8 years that the guy you're just trading, you know, was. That's the real nub of this whole business, and it takes a lot of courage to be able to do that.
And that's what the St. Louis Cardinals did with Albert Pujols when they let him walk, and that's what Belichick does in football all the time. Let's quickly thank BiteSquad.com. Upload the BiteSquad app, upload your information, and you get great restaurant quality food delivered to you wherever you are, home or office, or wherever you happen to be at any time. Breakfast, lunch, and dinner. A lot of great Minneapolis restaurants now and Twin Cities restaurants. You can also sign up for $5.99 to get free delivery from anywhere all month, from anywhere within 4 miles. BiteSquad.com, BiteSquad app, and use the promo code TalkNorth if you haven't used them before. You get your first delivery fee waived. So 2 more things I want to get to. One is the reason I see upside for this Twins team. Number 2 is a movie recommendation. First, what I see is a team that is on a record pace for home runs, Roy, and yet is just getting Miguel Sano started and hasn't seen a classic home run hitting spree from Nelson Cruz. Even though he's been very good, has high OPS, has been great situationally, he also sat out a lot of interleague games and had a minor injury. You know, I see the two classic power hitters on this roster not having produced as much home run power as you could have expected. I see upside there.
There's no question there's upside there. And I will add that I think in Nelson Cruz's case, it's vitally important to the Twins for him to have a classic Nelson Cruz hot half. He's really the guy. And I mean, he's the third hitter. He's the guy that is the example for everybody else, and I'm really hoping that we see a classic hot streak from Nelson Cruz, because if we do, they're going to run away with it. I mean, if Cruz gets hot, then watch what Kepler and Rosario do. Watch what Polanco does. Watch what Byron Buxton does, and all of them. You know, I mean, you're right. There's big upside there, and I think in at least one of those spots, you know, the third spot, it's pretty important that happen.
Absolutely. And if Cruz has a great second half, then I think you'll see the Twins exercising the team option, getting back one of their most important hitters and personalities for a real bargain next year, too, so that it would really set up the immediate future as well. My movie recommendation, actually the boxer Jamal James, who I've been covering as he tries to get to a title fight, he and his trainer recommended The Black Godfather on Netflix. Clarence Avant, who I'm kind of embarrassed because I'm a music guy and I'm a history guy, I'm a sports guy, and I really didn't know who this guy was. This guy is the guy who got Jim Brown into the movies. He's the guy who got Henry Aaron his biggest endorsement deal ever. He was friends with three different presidents. He formed two record labels. He helped, you know, get Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis their big break in the music business. Fascinating guy. Absolute fascinating guy. Check out The Black Godfather on Netflix. Roy, do you have any music or movie recommendations for us this week?
You know, we're talking so much baseball. I've got some music I've been listening to that I am really excited about, and I'll just tease it a little bit. Maybe we can talk about it next week. But the list that I made, I have entitled Bluesy, Rocky, Jazzy.
Ooh.
And it's some good stuff, some of which you will have heard or heard of, and some I think maybe not. So I'm excited to talk about that.
That's a tease. That's a tease from Roy Smalley. Thanks to Roy Smalley. Thanks to our producer, Brandon Morton. It's going to be a fascinating summer. Thank you for listening to this show and TalkNorth.com. Subscribe to subscribe to Talk North on your favorite podcast app. Get all the shows with all our great personalities. And again, thanks to everybody who's helped make the network a success. We'll talk to you next week.
Yeah, yeah, oh yeah, what condition, my condition.